So, thank you very much for the kind introduction. Today I want to talk about our recent research results at the Helmholtz Center in Berlin. We are a large-scale facility located in East and West Berlin. We have a neutron reactor in East Berlin, in West Berlin, and a synchrotron source in the east of Berlin. We are mainly focusing on the methods to investigate lithium sulfur batteries, and not so much on the material. So always cooperations with material people are highly welcome. And what does multidimensional operando analysis means actually is that we build up a setup for our sulfur cathode investigations where we can make simultaneously more than two measurements, like for the sulfur cathode, for example. We have now built up a cell where we can, of course, run the impedance spectroscopy and the galvanostatic charge discharge, but also temperature, and then we can use photons or neutrons as probes while the cell is operating. And as I said, we are a large-scale facility. We can use small-angle neutron scattering, or we can use radiography or tomography. And this is the basic idea of this whole setup. So we do this research on the cathode side, but also on the anode side with silicon anodes, but this will be not part of this talk today. And there we look at the lithiation and delithiation processes of silicon, and also perform this in operando mode with different measurements. And so we can get all over these pertinent length scales and get our information out of this. And at this point, I really want to mention that it's very, very important, as we heard already, to design a very well working operando cell. And this is not such an easy task to do. So we have now version number 4 and version number 5 will come next. And now we get really nice curves. So just some basics for the radiography. Maybe some of you have seen already this radiography made by Wilhelm Conrad Röntgen. And what I want to show you is a very nice contrast between carbon and sulfur and Li2S. And because you have so much lithium in this phase, you have a much higher transmittance for the X-rays. And this is taken from another publication from our group. And this is an equivalent circuit model, but also using the distribution of relaxation times to really distinguish between different charge transfer processes. This is our model electrode, or the ideal electrode, with no binder needed. And this is known also as gas diffusion layer or non-woven carbon. We have already seen today one example. So this looks like spaghetti, and then you have this roughly 6 micrometer thick fibers, which are microporous. You can check this with nitrogen adsorption and small angle neutron scattering. This is our operando setup, I would say version number 3. And of course, this is not optimized to dead volume or electrolyte to carbon ratio, but it's one of the first cells which works very well from the point of view that the charge discharge curves look acceptable. So this is a standard CR2032 coin cell where we have a spring and a current, steel current collector with a lithium anode in the hole of 8 millimeters in the middle. Then we have a standard Selga 2500 separator, and then we have here our cloth-like material cathode. And then we perform radiography, charge discharge, and impedance spectroscopy, and combine everything together to get our conclusions out of this. So this is how the experiment will look like. So I guess we have to wait a little bit because it's quite a big video. It takes some time to load, hopefully. So, okay, here we are. So this is the program is running. We perform 5 cycles at 0.1 C and 5 at C over 4, C over 2, and then again one cycle at C over 10. What you can see is the formation of macroscopic phases. You can see this very dark spikes and dendrites. This is beta sulfur. And then at the end of the discharge, which come right now, you can see such a ring forming from the outside, because here is the source of the lithium, And then you see always at the end of the discharge this ring. And in between you see this formation. Now we go to a higher C rate. And as you see also this ring and the dendrite formation is different now. Now we go to even higher and you can see this effect. We have also seen already in the morning keynote talk by Selim Bashas that you have also an evolution of gas or of dry areas in the cathode material. But then when you go to 1C back, you have somehow a recovery of these dry areas. Okay, and now it starts again. So you get out five, I just focus now on the first 10 cycles. So you have five cycles at 0.1C. And you have every 20 seconds, you make an image of the radiography. And then you also have intermediate stops for doing potentiostatic EIS. So this was done at 0.1C, and these five cycles were done at C over 4. The capacity is okay with almost 1,000 milliampere hours per gram sulfur. And here you see a slight increase, and here you see a slight decrease at a higher C rate. But this is what you would expect. So when you now combine this with the results of the EIS and the distribution of relaxation times, you see here for 0.1C very nicely that you have two different relaxation processes. Every time when you have the sulfur precipitation, you see a quite narrow a charge transfer process, which is in full agreement with what Celine found also, that you have quite a small area where this precipitation occurs, but the precipitation of the Li2S, for example, is much broad over the discharge and charge. And every time, of course, when you have this dip here, you have also an increase in the resistance. But this is known, so we just zoom in into these two cycles. And there you can again see very sharp sulfur charge transfer process, and this correlates very well with the appearance and disappearance of these chunky sulfur dendrites. And when you increase the speed or the C rate, then you can see this also this mapping is changing. So this relaxation process is allocated to the Li2S formation process and solution precipitation and dissolution process. And this one, this is much more narrow, is corresponds to the sulfur charge transfer process. So this is also, as I told you, in full agreement with X-ray absorption spectroscopy, which was also done in the operando mode by Cuisinier et al. So you see the occurrence of the sulfur dendrite precipitation, and the dissolution is very well correlated to this area of this red shading here. And also the Warburg impedance and the solution resistance reflect ion depletion during the solid phase appearance. And the Li2S precipitation is, as I told you, in a good agreement. So we can really say this is the charge transfer connected to this process and this one to the sulfur precipitation. And when you, on the very first five cycles, you can compare these dry areas or white stains, what you can see in the video, at the end of the discharge, and then you compare it to the capacity of what you have measured with your galvanic static charge discharge, and you see that this is a very nice correlation. So it's really, if you have more, makes also sense, if you have a lot of inactive area, you will have, of course, less discharge capacity. Then we can do also this measurement with a much higher resolution at the synchrotron radiation source at the BESI 2. And here you can see directly you have the formation of two different sulfur phases. So here you have the alpha phase, which is the rhombic phase, and then here you have also this kind of phase formation, which could be correlated to this beta sulfur phase. And these dendrites, because it's an imaging method, it can really now follow how fast they dissolve and how fast they dissolve. And as you can see, you have a low transmittance when you form the dendrite, and in the vicinity of the dendrites, you have a depletion of sulfur species. And when you dissolve it, you get again more sulfur around the dendrites. So this is quite a fast dissolution, because although it's a large volume and it's an insulating material, this works very fast, and these dendrites can grow up with a velocity of 1.2 micrometer per second, so they really shoot over here this electrode. This is another study with a different cathode material, and where we do a cyclic voltammetry, and this is the first charge. So we always start, in this case, with the Li2S8 solution. So the very first step is the precipitation of solid sulfur, and then you can see we have already some sulfur clusters on the surface, but they grow in three different regimes when you take the points A, B, C until F, and you can really measure and calculate how this volume will increase with time. And you can see here it's different growing rates during the first charge. The occurrence of alpha and beta sulfur is already well known from other XID operando measurements, like from Kanyas and from Silvia Walusch, who is also in the audience today, I guess. And so it was not unexpected to see both phases in parallel for our imaging experiment. This is another result of our measurements. And you can see here this reaction front, which will occur at the end of every discharge step. And here from the images A to F. And as you can see, it's a circular inwards migration of high transmittance phase at the end of every discharge. One assumption is now that this is due to the high lithium ion concentration, which migrates inwards. And you can also measure this radius of this ring, and then you can make the first derivative, and then you get the velocity, and you see also this is in the range like the growth of the sulfur dendrites, 0.1 micrometer per second in the maximum. So just let me conclude our findings. So we have the first X-ray radiography of a lithium sulfur cell. We can see the occurrence was appearance of two different sulfur phase, the alpha and the beta phase. Then we have a good correlation of the EIS and the appearance of the sulfur dendrites, and also the distribution of relaxation times agree well with the formation of Li2S compared to X-ray adsorption spectroscopy results. You see at higher C rates a dry out effect inside of the coin cell, but you can also see a recovery during charge with low C rate. And then you can analyze this dry-out effect or recovery effect in the very first five cycles and also the other cycles. And you can see this is strongly, of course, as expected, correlated to the capacity fading. With this imaging method in high resolution, you can really check out how these solid phases grow. And at the discharge, you can see also a nice effect, but we are still performing more experiments on this here to understand this effect, because no matter what cathode material we have, we see always this effect. So, and our outlook next steps are also these operando tomography measurements. This measurement was taken at the synchrotron radiation source and BESI-2. And here you can see in yellow the sulfur, and in white you can see more dry areas of this gas diffusion layer. And the darker areas are wetted areas. So this is one version. Next version is already built, and now we hope get even better wetting and also better charge-discharge curves. The good thing here is that we can do simultaneously the energy dispersive X-ray diffraction measurements, electrochemical impedance, the tomography, and charge-discharge curve at the same time. Now I want to thank my co-workers, Professor Balloff, who is the head of our institute, and Professor Yan Lu, who is supporting us with synthetic colloidal approaches for the materials, and postdocs Chai Yafta and Yan Yang, who are working in my group. Then also Ingo Manke is also a cooperator from Celine Barsha, who is head of the imaging group, and his postdocs, and then our friends and colleagues from the University of Hamburg, with the group from Professor Michael Fröber and Professor Simone Mascotto. And thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you. We have time for a few questions from the audience. At the back.
So when you have the same results,
Good idea. We can check it out, but maybe we can talk later about this idea. But we have not performed this experiment. Ah, okay. Okay.
I have one question. Sorry. Why do you think the cell reheals itself over time? Do you have some extra gas volume inside the cell?
Exactly. Yeah. This is okay. This is what I mean with constructing a very good operando cell. A coin cell has dead volume. So electrode can be pushed out of the cathode material, but also can flow back into this material because the electrolyte will always try to wet the surface. So that could be this healing effect. And that means at lower C-rates you are not pushing so much out anymore, the electrolyte. The new versions have no dead volume at all, and it's really pressed together like a plate tape capacitor. And then we hope we get much more industrial relevant results with this cell.
Okay, thank you.
I have a quick one. How about the electrolyte sulfur ratio in this case for sulfur dendrite formation?
Good idea. I have to check it in the publication. I have it not in my mind. Okay.
Very, very interesting, Doc. I was wondering if you were to charge and discharge at very high rates, like C rate, does it mean that you will only be in the soluble region and sulfur precipitation region and never go into the lithium sulfide or disulfide region? Is that a fair statement?
This could be. We will have an ongoing investigation on this with higher C rates, of course. These were really the first results we got. We just started in the end of 2013 with batteries at all. And now we get the really first good results. But I'm really welcome all these suggestions how to perform experiments, because from an electrochemical point of view, we are just doing what most of the people do. So we take the same salts and the electrolyte, but just to get really core aspects out of the system, we really appreciate your suggestions. So
thank you.
Any more questions? If not, let's thank Sebastian again.
Thank you.
Thank you. Before introducing the next speaker, may I know if Dr. Marcus Hagen is in the audience?